Hello, and welcome to MindYourMind.net and Galactic Science. I'm Ace. I was asked to do a little video on the power production I use in Galactic Science, and so I said I would, and here we are. Let's get started. This is the TARDIS, the inside of the TARDIS, of course, and we're looking at a quickie tree farm that I had built some time ago. You see the Ender IO farming station and the dimensional transceiver right on top of it, and I sprinkled my dirt out every other space, the temporal dirt, because with this trees this size, trunks this size, you really don't need it in every space to get the result you're looking for. As you can see, this tree farm is producing really a substantial amount of wood pretty quick. This is feeding my syngas producing facility, which is what's generating the power. So without further ado, I'll go ahead and go down there. I'll pause real quick and then go down there and we can take a look at the actual power production room. All right, here we are in the power production room. This is at the bottom of the base. This is where I actually produce all the power. Start here with the cobblestone generator. You'll see why in just a moment. I'm running three transfer nodes into a Java barrel. And that barrel is piping up through this Ender IO conduit here into this crafter tier 3 from RF Tools. And in there I did a little poor man's filter, just sort of filled up some slots in there so that it wouldn't get too full. Here we can see that what we're piping in is the spruce wood, and we've told it to, hey, go ahead and turn that into planks. Keep one in inventory, which means here in this slot right here there will always be at least one wood here. If there were to be a shortage of wood all of a sudden for some reason and all of these woods were to get used up, the crafter moves very fast, so it would pretty easily craft all the wood and all of a sudden have an empty space here, which means then that your cobblestone would take over that space and that wouldn't be so good. That'd break your system. So we've told it to keep one in inventory, and we've told it to put the result, which would be the planks, back in inventory right here. Then again, we've told that to go ahead and keep one in inventory and to return that to internal once it's produced the sticks. There's the sticks. Then we've finally told it to produce stone axes from the cobblestones that are coming in from the generator and from the sticks. Again, we're keeping one in hand, so there's always a slot for that stick to go into, and we are and the cobble, and then we are piping that to the external interface that pipes it up over through the pipe here and down into this Java barrel. That goes into this dimensional transceiver, which is set to pull. That pulls the axes, loads them into the send slot. That sends them out to the farms. So the farms get an endless supply of stone axes, which are basically free from the cobblestone generator and the tree farm itself. The saplings get piped into this Java barrel, which has a void upgrade on it, so that any excess gets voided. And we can see that the priority on the Ender IO conduit is a 5. Going into the crafter, and a 0 here on the Java barrel. So the first place logs are going to go is up into the crafter, and then after that, when that gets full, which is pretty quick obviously, they come down here into this Java barrel. This Java barrel is feeding this syngas producer. Here's the controller for it, and here is the output. Let me go ahead and grab onto a conduit so the stuff opens up, and you can see we pipe out into this syngas bedrockian drum. That pipes out into these two machines and into this third one. The reason I use the drum is so that it's very easy to keep track of whether you're gaining or losing, and so that you've got a lot of buffer. You know, if we have a problem with the tree farm or you need to move a tree farm, you can go ahead and do that and not have to worry about everything breaking down right away. These three kick on and they all power up this vibrant capacitor bank, which has a capacity of 4¾ billion. Right now you can see that we're bringing in about 7,000-8,000, which is what I have from some passive sources of power generation. But we're putting out 11, so over time this thing drops down. And what happens when it does is that this power monitor right here from Ender IO is connected to the vibrant capacitor bank, and that is set on this tab to emit a redstone signal when we're less than 90%. So as soon as we get below 90, this thing puts out a redstone signal. This redstone control module, which is part of the generator, When I see a signal, I am set to turn on fuel use. So that goes ahead and turns on the generator. You can see that I've got another Ender IO power monitor right here. That's actually triggering both of these at the same time. They have a similar, hey, when this turns on, I go ahead and I turn on the thing. But this one is configured a little differently. These both kick on when we get down to 75%. So if I'm using a little bit of power, I get down to 90, the one kicks on and keeps us topped off. But if I'm using a lot of power, say I put some upgrades on the Ender Quarries, then we drop down to 75. That says, hey, you know what? The one's not enough. Let's kick on the other two. These are vibrant turbines. Each of these has the maximum amount, which is 50. They produce 500 RF per tick each. So you're looking at 25,000 RF per tick per generator setup. Each one has the fuel air mixer and the gas mix compressor on it so that we get better fuel efficiency. These fuel tanks aren't really needed because of the Bedrockian drum, but I had them, so I went ahead and tossed them on the top. I think they look kind of cool. Otherwise, it's just a whole lot of vibrant turbine blocks, obviously, and then you've got the capacitor. Again, really not needed. It's just a little bit of extra stored capacity in the generator itself. And then, of course, you've got the gas turbine controller. So with each of these, we produce 25,000 RF per tick. That's a total of 75,000 going into this capacitor. These vibrant capacitor, or these dimensional transceivers, rather, are what are providing power for each of the channels. So here we can go and look at the channel, and we can see that I'm sending out on ACE power. The other one says ACE power 2. This is the one that's coming in from the passive sources. So everything feeds into this capacitor bank, and then this capacitor bank feeds my two primary channels from which everything is powered in the base. That's the power generation for my Galactic Science setup on MineYourMind.net. I'll put a link to them down in the description, because I think they're a great server to play on. And if you like this video, hit like, hit subscribe. I'll be producing more. And if you have any questions about anything that I showed here, certainly post them and I'll answer them and or do another video to explain that. If there's anything else down here that you want to see explained, I'll probably be doing those videos here pretty quickly. And I appreciate your time watching. Again, this is Ace signing off. You have a good day.